My name is Morgan McMonagall, and I'd like to thank Francesca and Pablo for the warm invite to chair this session. I'm a trauma and critical care surgeon at St. Mary's and Imperial College in London. And so I'm not an intensivist, I will sit up straight, but I'm certainly looking forward to hearing about these exciting topics today. So our first speaker will be Jose Garnacho Montero from the University Hospital of the Virgin Macarena in Seville. And he has a whole wealth of publications on infections in the lung and ICU, and in particular antibiotic resistance. From University College London here, we've got Mervyn Singer, who is online too, hello, and who has a wealth of research behind him too, from Wellcome Trust, the Medical Research Council, and also National Institute for Health Research here in the UK. And is also the author, or one of the co-authors of the Oxford Handbook of Critical Care. And any of you who have authored or co-authored the book know how much work really goes into that and how little money comes out of it. And then following that, we will have a talk I'm extremely interested in, because it's something I know very little about, but having spent some time in Johannesburg General Hospital a number of years ago on the trauma service, we have Kuba Naidu, who's a paediatric intensivist from Barry Ryan in Soweto, who has special interest, obviously, in paediatric ICU, mechanical ventilation, and also critical care nephrology. So I think, without further ado, we will start and welcome Jose Garnacho Montero from Seville, who's going to speak to us this morning on invasive fungal infections in the hemo-oncological patient admitted to ICU, a focus on diagnosis and treatment. And certainly we all know that these patients are extremely difficult to manage, because not just because of the underlying disease, but once they get a superinfection with a fungus, it's extremely difficult. And unfortunately, as you know, many of them are young, fit patients who linger for a long time. So welcome, Jose, and the floor is yours. We have no sound.
Pepe, ya puedes compartir tu pantalla y comenzar tu presentación. Perfecto.
Have we got sound? Yes. Francesco, I can't hear him. I don't know if anybody else can.
No, not at the moment.
Jose is coming. I think we can wait a minute. It should start.
Okay.
I'll chat you a bit later.
Sorry?
I'll chat you a little bit later. I'll let you know the timing. I could handle it a little bit down. At the moment, just a little bit of my head that pops into the screen.
Can you hear Francesca? I cannot hear.
Yes, I can hear you.
But can I hear Jose?
I'm waiting to hear. One second.
Okay.
We move to the second, and then we reconnect with yourself, if possible. So, Marvin, maybe, if you can share the slides.
You want me, Marvin? Are
yes,
you happy
please.
To start, Marvin?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Okay, so we'll move on to the second speaker, and hopefully we will have wire for sound with Jose. So we welcome Marvin, the senior from UCL in London, to speak about lung sepsis in the immunocompromised etiology and diagnostic challenges.
Lovely. I've got at the moment, Carlos is that's it, now I can share. Right, lovely. Hang on a minute. Entire screen share. Right, can you see my slides?
We can see, you need to put full screen. Yes.
Yes,
perfect.
We can now, yes.
Lovely. Hi. Okay. Good morning, everyone from London. So delighted to talk to you about lung sepsis in the immunosuppressed patient and the challenges that we faced. And this is a picture of my intensive care unit in London. And as you can see, we're making lots of cutbacks. Clearly, we're seeing more and more increasing populations of immunosuppressed patients, oncological transplant, inflammatory bowel disease patients, arthropathies, HIV, etc. And they often develop lung-related complications. So clearly an important question, do they have infection? Does that lead to organ dysfunction and sepsis? And clearly, if it is infection, is it bacterial, viral, fungal, atypical? On the other hand, the complication may be a direct consequence of the disease, like lymphangitis, hemophagocytosis, or commonly iatrogenic. So lots of examples, graft versus host disease, fibrosis, pneumonitis, cytokine release syndrome, and so forth. And unfortunately, radiology often shows us that something's wrong, but it doesn't necessarily give us an absolute diagnostic. So you may be able to see with cannonball pictures with aspergillosis, but often you don't see these characteristic radiological features. And as you can see, to a large extent, there's a huge overlap in both the chest x-ray and the CT scan in many of these patients. Unfortunately, patients don't often follow the rule book, or at least their x-rays and scans don't.
Vale, estamos viendo cómo el juego que está poniendo al que está hablando, que por cierto también es...
Oh, shall I continue?
Yes, please do. Can anyone who's not speaking just mute your microphones? Just to make it easier. Thank you.
Lovely, thank you. We're getting also an increasing risk from the increasing complexity of the treatments we're giving, especially in cancer therapy. So there's CAR T therapy, which are modified T cells, monoclonal antibodies, immunostimulants, and even conventional chemotherapy regimens are getting in many cases more aggressive. And these often work by trying to stimulate the body's own immune system to combat the cancer. However, by stimulating the immune system, you can hyperstimulate and then get many of the downstream consequences like cytokine storm, hemophagocytosis, etc., that can very closely mimic the clinical manifestations of sepsis. This is an example on the cytokine release syndrome. And as you'll see from this picture, there's many, many manifestations, cardiovascular, neurological, hepatitic, hematological, renal, etc., and lung. So the patient can get tachypneic, they can get hypoxemic, and they can show an ARDS type picture on their x-ray or their scan. There's also this interesting condition that over the last few years has gained increasing interest called hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis, HLH. And this is a very good review article in Blood that came out a few months ago. And it's this hyperinflammatory syndrome induced by hyperactivation of macrophages and killer cytotoxic T cells. There's a primary form, which is genetically acquired, mainly in children, but the secondary form can be triggered by a number of insults. So infections, in particular viruses like Epstein-Barr virus, HIV, CMV, which are much more common in immunosuppressed patients, but you can also get it from bacteria, parasites, fungi. Malignancies themselves, especially lymphomas, can also trigger this HLH syndrome, and other causes seen in immunosuppressed patients. Transplantation, iatrogenic immunosuppression can also induce it. And as this article mentions, the point I made earlier, that patients may present with a phenotype, a clinical appearance, which is indistinguishable from sepsis or multi-organ failure. How do we differentiate it? Well, there are some clues. There's this scoring system where you get more points if you have immunosuppression, if you have a very high temperature, and sometimes these patients have a higher temperature than is seen in septic patients. They often have a big liver or a big spleen. They may have pancytopenias, but not always. The ferritin level can go up with sepsis, but it goes up to very high levels in HLH. The triglyceride levels go up with this syndrome. Fibrinogen goes up, the liver enzymes go up, and you may see either in a blood film or on a bone marrow aspirate evidence of macrophages, monocytes eating other white blood cells or red cells. So again, we have a problem. It could be infection, it could be lots of other things. So what biomarkers are useful for identifying lung sepsis in these patients? And so, yes, we often fall back on the usual suspects like C-reactive protein, procalcitonin, but they're actually rather so-so in terms of sensitivity and specificity. This is a nice study from Sweden, and they here looked at procalcitonin, CRP, and citrulline in febrile neutropenic patients who they felt were either infected or non-infected. And as you can see, there was very poor differentiation between those who were inflamed but infected and those who were inflamed but not infected. Here's a study from Germany. Again, they looked at patients who, this is a pediatric population after stem cell transplantation, and looked at PCT, procalcitonin, on the left-hand side and CRP on the right-hand side. And the groups, you can see the white box are bacterial, presumed bacterial. The striped box is a viral, viremia, and the black box is a fungemia. And you can see there that and the gray shaded boxes are the control group. And you can see that during an infection, there was a rise in PCT and in CRP, which generally was higher in those with bacterial infection, although there was some overlap with viral and fungal. However, in terms of specificity, not that good. So they also looked at patients with graft versus host disease, either skin in white boxes, intestinal in striped boxes, liver in black. And you can see that these were also elevated during the acute phase of the graft versus host and at similar levels to those seen with infection. Likewise, other graft issues, giving anti-thymocyte globulin, graft rejection, engraftment syndrome. Again, there was this rise during the acute problem, rising to similar levels seen with infection. Also, the same signal with veno-occlusive disease or mucositis. Again, an inflammatory process causing the CRP and the procalcitonin to rise. So unfortunately, they're not, you know, they're fairly sensitive, but they're not very specific. This is from one sort of recommendation that perhaps if the CRP and the procalcitonin levels are very low, you don't need to give an antibiotic. If they're very, very high, this guideline strongly encourages them, but many patients fall in the middle and clearly, you know, there's uncertainty. And human factors, you know, doctors tend to react more actively in patients who are immunosuppressed because of fear of them not being able to fight the infection. And so these patients often get treated regardless, despite the fact that they might not actually have an infection. So we've got, obviously, the standard ways of looking at bacterial pathogen in the lung. And I think it's fair to say that they're okay to a point, but they're not that good. You know, we have often to wait a few days before something's grown. If the patient's been getting an antibiotic, that may suppress the growth. But now more and more companies are developing molecular diagnostics. There's nucleic acid amplification tests, RT-PCR, and now even newer than that, there's metagenomics using next generation sequencing and what's called 16S rRNA. Viruses, again, in immunosuppressed patients, as I mentioned earlier, there are many viruses that can cause lung infection. CMV, EBV, herpes viruses, chest viruses, you know, that we're familiar with, rhinovirus, adenovirus, influenza, paroinfluenza, and so forth. And again, you can look at RT-PCR, look at viral load occasionally, but it's not routinely done. You can do electron microscopy. The good thing are there are lots of companies now in the space developing technologies. This is one example. This is the Biomeria BioFire system, which looks at a pneumonia panel. And the advantage is it's quick to do. You put the fluid into a cartridge, put it into a machine that can be essentially a point of care machine, and you get your result in about an hour. And it gives most of the common pathogens. So you've got a load of bacterial ones, as shown on the this slide, a few atypical ones like Legionella, Mycoplasma, Chlamydia, and a series of viruses, flu A, flu B, RSV, etc., and some resistance genes. Again, a warning about resistance genes. There are hundreds, if not thousands, of resistance genes. So just because the patient doesn't show necessarily a resistance to a penicillin, an ESBL, there may be other resistance genes that aren't being measured. So it's not an absolute guarantee of sensitivity. But as I mentioned just previously, lots and lots of other companies are in the space. So again, I'm not promoting one particular company, but just to highlight the fact that technology is improving and we can get rapid answers. These technologies, usually within 2 to 5 hours of taking the sample, you can get a result. I won't talk in any detail about fungi because I know Jose is going to be talking about that. And there are a variety of different biomarkers that can be used, apart from the gold standard of fungal culture and histopathology, getting tissue. And I'm sure he'll talk in more detail about beta-D-glucan, which is non-specific for invasive fungal infections, but there are lots of false positives, and galactomannan, which is relatively specific for Aspergillus. A quick final word on the future. I think our ability to actually image the lung and visualize bacteria and other pathogens is coming. So I'm working with this guy, Kev Dalliwell, who's a professor in Edinburgh, and this is an academic multidisciplinary project with physicists, chemists, optical engineers, and the idea is through a bronchoscope, you can place a fiber optic cable and do confocal imaging within the lung. So the idea is this fiber optic probe goes actually through into the lung, so you're creating little mini pneumothoraces. They've done about 30-odd patients already in Edinburgh without any serious clinical problem. And you can, through these this little sensor, inject 50 microliters of spray, and these have probes that can show up various things. I'll give you an example in the next slide. But this is a little video going down the lung or down the trachea, and now you can see into the lung, and you can see this is in a human lung. You can see these are just above the alveoli, and you can see the beautiful architecture of the lung in real time. But when you add different probes and sensors, you can look at fibrosis, you can look at cancer cells, and you can also look at activated white cells and bacteria. So the video on the top left is a patient who has too much fluid. You can actually see the edema. On the right, alveolar collapse, and you can see how the alveoli and the supraalveoli spaces are collapsed down. They're not normal. And the bottom image video, you can see little twinkling, I hope. So they look like little stars, and they're actually bacteria. This is a patient with pneumonia, and you can image the bacteria in real time. And through the port that you inject it into, you can sample fluid and then obviously do your diagnostics and work out this gram-positive bacteria is X, Y, or Z. So in summary, I think this patient cohort are an important and increasing but tricky cohort in whom to accurately diagnose lung sepsis. And unfortunately, it's confounded by many diseases causing lung complications or many complications related to the treatment of these diseases. But this improvement in technology, both in identifying the pathogen and the host response, will, I think, improve our diagnostic capabilities, and I think we'll be much, much better at trying to avoid unnecessary antibiotic exposure. And on that note, thank you very much indeed for listening. I'll hand you back.
Thank you very much, Roman. Fantastic insights there. I particularly like where the future might be going with regards to diagnostics in this population, so we look forward to that. I think we have power now with Jose Garnacho Montero, so we move straight to Jose, if you're ready to discuss invasive fungal infections in the hemo-oncological patient population in ICU.
Okay. good morning, Francevit. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, we can.
Excellent. Great. So my task today is to review fungal infection in onco-hematological patients. And just a second. Okay, first of all, I would like to thank Pablo Cardenal for this excellent initiative and for the success of this project. And my task today is to review rapidly the fungal infection in onco-hematological patients. Everybody knows that fungal infection has a high mortality morbidity, especially in vulnerable patients like onco-hematological patients, and then an early diagnosis and adequate early therapy is essential to improve the survival. And delayed diagnosis and treatment is obviously associated with a very, very high mortality. Worldwide, the three most important causes of fungal infection are Aspergillus, in this population Aspergillus, Mucor, and Cryptococcus. bad recently the rate of other fungi like Fusarium and Scedopolium and Blastomyces are increasing in this population. But as I said before, in 15 minutes it's very, very difficult or almost impossible to review all these fungi for the due to the short period of time that I have. And if we talk about fungi, we have to think about Nemosystis gillivensis that nowadays, as everybody knows, is considered as a fungus. Patient with a pulmonary fungal infection, clinical presentation is not specific with fever, cough, dyspnea, and very frequently hemoptysis, but you cannot differentiate what kind of fungi is causing this respiratory infection. Respiratory failure is very common and very frequently requires non-invasive mechanical ventilation, high flow oxygen therapy, and invasive mechanical ventilation that it is associated with a higher mortality. Diagnosis can be made with different tools, but imaging is very important, and I will show you later on. This slide is just to speak about the importance of knowing new risk factor, because everybody knows that neutropenia is a risk factor for fungal infection, but many new therapies that we are using are associated with a high incidence of fungal infection, especially, as you can see in this slide, ibrutinib, that is a brutin kinase inhibitor used for chronic lymphoid leukemia or whatever macroglobulinemia, is associated with fungal infection, especially with Aegilus, Cryptococcus, and Pneumocystis gillivensis. Diagnosis is based on imaging, blood culture, the yellow blood culture is very low, have with the extension of Fusarium and some species of Aspergillus, especially Aspergillus terreo, direct examination and culture of respiratory samples, serological and molecular tests for that can be done from in blood and in BAL, 1,3 beta glucan, as Dr. Singer told before, is not specific for any of these fungus and is found in positive in Candida, Aspergillus, Nemosystis gillivensis, and as well as in Fusarium. Galactomanan is relatively specific for Aspergillus, and the detection of DNA by PCR has been developed for different fungi, especially for Aspergillus, for Nemosystis, as well as for Mucorales. And always the dilemma of intubated or not intubated patient, or the dilemma of performing a BLA or no BLA. This has to be decided case by case with a careful evaluation of the risk benefit, of the risk benefit. And of course, we can use some support with high flow oxygen therapy or with invasive mechanical ventilation. The risk factor of invasive aspergillosis are well known now. All these hematological patients, especially patients with neutropenia, patients with hematological cancer on the top, acute myeloid leukemia, and patients with allogeneic stem cell cell transplantation are those who are more vulnerable for this fungi. The diagnosis, as I explained before, with for the rest of the fungi, imaging diagnosis, the direct examination and culture, Aspergillus grows in 2 to 5 days, but culture yield is very, very low, and the serological and molecular test, galactomanan, 1,3 beta glucan, lateral flow devices, this is a point of care machine that has been developed, and the detection of Aspergillus DNA by PCR. This is an example of X-ray with nodules, this is a diffuse involvement of both lungs with small nodules in a patient with invasive aspergillosis, and this is the typical sign of air crescent and the allo sign that you can see the allo sign on the left the left hand side and the air crescent in the right hand side. This is very uncommon in non-neutropenic patients, but you can see these typical images are seen more frequently in patients with neutropenia. This is the reverse allocyte that you can see here. As you can see, in the center of the lesion is a ground glass pattern with a solid consolidation in the exterior, and this is not typical of Aspergillus, this is typical of mucor, but this is not pathognomonic of mucor. We have to think of mucor because this is an infection with a very, very high mortality, and especially in those patients treated with prophylaxis with voriconazole, because voriconazole is not active against mucor, so there is an increasing incidence of this of pulmonary syncomycosis in this patient. And of course, you have to be very attentive because syncomycetus is not treated, is not covered by voriconazole, and you have to have this suspicion, especially with galactomannan is negative. Just one slide for the syncomycosis, very important. Treatment is liposomal amphotericin B at high doses, and isavuconazole that we discussed later on is also active against this fungi. Galactomannan testing is relatively specific for Aspergillus because it's found only in this fungi and this fungus and in penicillin. It can be detected in serum, urine, cerebral spinal flow, or ELA. And it can anticipate the diagnosis because 6 to 8 days before a clinical site can be detected galactomannan. The sensitivity and specificity is higher in patients with neutropenia, and the cutoff has been discussed largely, 0.5, two determinations, 0.5, 0.7, or 1, but probably the cutoff in the 1 provides the best operative performance for this test. I recommend a careful reading of this document published 2 months ago in September about from the ATS about the medical laboratory testing in the diagnosis of fungal infection, and I recommend an attentive reading. And this is also a classic study demonstrating that the yield of Aspergillus galactomannan in blood is much higher than in serum, especially in non-neutropenic patients, but also in neutropenic patients. So when you have a suspicion of invasive aspergillosis or a fungal infection, you have to perform, after a careful evaluation, a BLA to obtain galactomannan. And galactomannan, of course, can be measured also in blood, and the yield is relatively high in neutropenic patients, but not in non-neutropenic patients. Regarding treatment in this cartoon, I summarize the recommendation from the ITSA published in 2016 and from the ESIL, the European Conference on International Leukemia, in 2017. And in both, the first line treatment is voriconazole, but isavuconazole appears as an alternative therapy by the ITSA or by the ESIL as a primary therapy at the same level of voriconazole. Liposomal amphotericin B is now a second line agent, as echinocandin never used in monotherapy. One of the problems of voriconazole is that steady-state blood concentration has large interpersonal variability and can be affected by many, many circumstances like age, drug interactions, and several genetic factors. And for this reason, it is we should monitor drug concentration at the steady state because it is very frequently found. It is very frequently found high or low level. This is a study in patients with neutropenia, and as you can see in the lower part of the slide, a high proportion of patients, more than 60% hematologic malignancy, the levels are lower than the low limit, is lower than 1 milligram per milliliter. So therapeutic failure is almost the rule in these cases. And as well, there are also high level with potential toxicity. The use of voriconazole in real life has been associated with a lower mortality. This is an study published in 2011 in patients with hematological malignancy in the ICU and with invasive pulmonary sparing and in the multivariate analysis that are controlling for variables of confusion variables. Voriconazole was associated with a lower mortality, as you can see also in this Kaplan-Meier curve. This is a series recently published this month of December in intensive care medicine. It's a French study, a multicenter French study, a retrospective study, 2019 patients included. The more frequently diagnosed hematological malignancy were acute myeloid leukemia and non-Hodgkin lymphoma. And as you can see in this cartoon, the use of voriconazole is the blue line is associated with a higher survival than the treatment with other drugs different from voriconazole. This is the red line. So after controlling for different variables, the same in this slide you have also all of the three circumstances. And in the multivariate analysis, the use of voriconazole was strongly associated with a lower mortality. Regarding the radiological pattern, as you can see, a diffuse pattern in the X-ray or the CT scan was associated with that higher mortality. And importantly, the time between symptom onset and ICU admission, more than 5 days, is also associated with a higher mortality. So the sooner the patient admitted to the ICU, the higher the probability of survival. And just the two last slides to review. This drug is voriconazole. It has been compared with voriconazole for the treatment of invasive aspergillosis and other filamentous fungi because this azole is active against mucor. This is a randomized free controlled trial. The majority of these patients were patients with pathological malignant disease with a high proportion of neutropenia. Unfortunately, no patients in the ICU were included in this clinical trial. In fact, mechanical ventilation was a reason for exclusion. And as you can see, the clinical cue, the primary outcome, was exactly the same with isavuconazole and voriconazole, but safety of isavuconazole was much better because the incidence of hematobiliary disorder, of visceral disorder, or skin and subcutaneous lesion was significantly higher with voriconazole than with isavuconazole. That way, it can be used as first-line agent. Although, as I mentioned before, no patients in the ICU were included in this study. So, just to conclude, the management of invasive fungal infection in onchomatoid patients constitutes a real challenge for physicians, for clinicians. Early diagnosis is crucial for survival. And of course, the clinician should keep in mind all risk factors and a high index of suspicion for detection of this fungal infection and to perform all the appropriate tests to rule out or to confirm this suspicion. For invasive pulmonary aspergillosis, voriconazole is the first line agent associated with lower mortality than that. Previously used antifungal drugs, but isavuconazole is a very interesting and valid alternative, although more experienced in ICU patients. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Jose, for a very insightful talk on a very difficult condition. One can't help but think that once you see invasive fungal infection in an ICU population, that it's almost game up, but it's good to see the battle continues. We'll move straight on to Kuben Naidoo from Baragwanath in South Africa to speak to us about one very challenging group of patients, outcomes of severe pneumonia in the pediatric population with HIV in South Africa.
Okay, good afternoon from Soweto, Johannesburg. Thanks very much to Pablo and Francesca for the opportunity to be part of this amazing event. And I'm going to be talking about the outcomes of pneumonia in children with HIV in a South African PICU. So I'd like to start by just reminding maybe the wider audience that it's been suggested that ICU facilities may not be the best idea in countries that have undefined mortality rates in excess of 30 per thousand live births. So if you're looking at South Africa, in the last 10 years, we started off at 56.6, and we've shown steady improvements. But as of 2018, we're still above the 30 mark. So it makes sense that we should feel as practitioners that it's quite a privilege to be able to offer these services to children in our communities. So talking about HIV, I mean, it's quite clear that Sub-Saharan Africa has borne the brunt of this disease process. And this graph shows clearly that in the sort of period between 1986 and 2005, there was almost a linear increase in the number of cases in the region. And all of that changed dramatically around the 2004-2005 mark with the introduction of highly active antiretroviral therapies into our country. And I think the impact is probably best displayed by this graph, which looks at population pyramids. So on the left, we have the population pyramid from 1990 in South Africa. And you can see there's a marked change in the shape 20 years later, now that we're 5 years into the availability of antiretrovirals. And you can see that a lot more patients were sort of reaching the 10 to 20 age group. And 5 years later, in 2015, we see that that's a sustained effect. And this has really been largely due to the presence of antiretrovirals. Looking at why children die in our setting in particular, this is taken from 2013. Sepsis is two-thirds of the number of deaths of children in our PICU, and amongst those diagnosed with sepsis, respiratory illness forms about two-thirds of that. So in terms of what we've shown within the country historically, so the first report dates back to 1996 out of Durban, and the survival of HIV, a ventilator in ICU, was listed as zero. In actual fact, those were children who met the clinical criteria for the diagnosis of AIDS rather than just HIV infection. A couple of years later, the Johannesburg experience was that we had a 12% survival. And then we had a bit of an outlier. There's a paper from 2001 from Cape Town, which listed the survival at 71%. However, this is a little bit inflated in that only one-third of the HIV-positive children in this paper were actually ventilated, and amongst those children, 50% survived. What did change, though, in that period was the introduction of corticosteroids to the treatment regimens for pneumocystis pneumonia. So this was a landmark paper in our setting. It dates back to 2003. And it looked at the effect of mechanical ventilation on HIV-positive patients. And in terms of survival, although the actual survival rates were different, it failed to reach statistical significance. And so this paper was widely quoted as being the justification for why children with HIV who required mechanical ventilation in our country were probably poor candidates. And so it spoke to the idea of utility. So this paper, which Prakash Jina authored in 2005, basically tried to explain the challenges that intensive care practitioners were facing when triaging children with HIV. And in fact, as part of the conclusion, he stated, if ventilation is not life-saving, then pragmatic adherence to a policy of refusal to offer ventilation to such individuals has to be followed. Fortunately, that paper sort of coincided with the introduction of the antiretrovirals. And then you'll see now that the survival subsequently has improved dramatically from 32% in 2003 to 68% in 2012. And a 2017 paper which looked at children around the period of 2010 showed 78% survival in HIV-positive patients ventilated. So the impact of the prevention of mother-to-child transmission of HIV is best illustrated by this graph which came out of the Lancet Infectious Disease 3 years ago. And what you can see is that from 2005 to 2012, the number of mothers who were HIV positive declined somewhat. But the number of women who were receiving antiretrovirals during their pregnancy increased dramatically. And the green line down the middle, that line basically shows that there was a marked drop-off in the number of children being born via vertical transmission with HIV. In South Africa, in 2011, the number of children born infected with HIV was down to 2.7%. However, maternal rates had not changed very much. So it meant that 30% of patients were still positive, and therefore 30% of children were being exposed to HIV in utero. And that gave birth to the idea that we may have an effect of HIV exposure even in the absence of HIV infection. So there have been numerous papers in the last few years which have been trying to explore this idea. And the most recent here from Frontiers in Immunology has shown that there's good evidence to suggest that T cell function and number in children who are HIV exposed but HIV negative is abnormal. So what is then the clinical impact of these children, the so-called HIV exposed uninfected? So this paper from a couple of years ago showed no difference actually in outcome in those children that were exposed but PCR negative. And this was followed up by information from a very large study, which was part of a bigger study that was done by a team that included Professor Shabir Mahdi out of Baragwanath. And they enrolled 3,500 patients and actually had HIV infection data on 2,500 infants, 71% of the cohort. They found that HIV infection was down to 8%. This was in the years 2010 to 2013. The number of children that were exposed and uninfected, very similar to the other stat, 34%, and HIV unexposed, 58%. If we look at the number of children who died from lower respiratory tract infections, there doesn't seem to be very much difference between the number. It's 24 in the exposed group and 20 in the unexposed group, giving us percentages of 3% and 2%. But when you analyze that, if you look specifically at in-hospital mortality, children that were exposed are at twice the risk of in-hospital mortality compared to children who are unexposed, uninfected. So this was the topic of a project that we looked at here at our ICU. So we did a two-year retrospective record review. We're a 9-bed PICU, it's intensivist led. We reviewed all patients that were admitted with an initial diagnosis of pneumonia. And then we compared the characteristics and outcomes of the patients grouped by HIV exposure and disease. We had HIV data for 90% of our cohort. The number of patients that were HIV infected were 23, which is just about 22%. And then we had 28 patients that were exposed but uninfected. It's previously been thought that malnutrition might be quite prevalent in these sorts of groups, but in our cohort, 2/3 of patients had normal weight for ages, and only 22, so 1 in 5 patients had severe malnutrition. There was no direct correlation between the presence of severe malnutrition and the presence of HIV infection. When we tried to compare the demographic baseline characteristics and the outcomes of the exposed and unexposed group, we found that none of these were statistically significant. And even at first glance, there's no obvious differences between whether it's length of stay, ventilator-free days, initial oxygenation index, and the ultimate outcome. The actual mortalities in the exposed group being 10.7 and in the unexposed group 11.1. When we compared these groups, though, to the HIV-infected group, we saw numerous differences on univariate analysis. So there was clearly longer length of stay in the HIV-infected, less ventilator-free days, a much higher initial oxygenation index, and then the actual mortality in this group was 34.8%. However, when we ran these through the multivariate analysis, HIV did not ultimately prove to be a predictor of outcome. In fact, the only predictor of outcome in the group was actually the initial severity of lung injury as evidenced by the admission OI. This had a p-value of less than 0.001 on multivariate analysis as a predictor of mortality. So the last thing that I wanted to touch on in this presentation was, although there hasn't been much by way of prediction of outcome in the papers that I've mentioned, Kitchen's work from 2012 listed the predicted mortality done both on PRISM and on the PIM2. There's quite a difference between the predicted mortality, nearly threefold higher mortality on the PIM2 rather than PRISM. And that is probably due to the fact that HIV is a parameter included in the PIM2. The actual mortality, though, was at 30%, which gave an SMR of 1.61. So we looked at patients who ultimately needed a high-frequency oscillation at our ICU. This was not an HIV study per se. And we found an SMR of 3.87 in our group. And then our HIV data, so looking at all 105 patients, our SMR came in at 2.35. But if you looked just at the group of those that were HIV positive, here we had a predicted mortality of 8.5% using the PIM3. And the actual mortality came back at 34.8, giving us an SMR of 4. So obviously this is quite concerning if we're trying to get an idea of our quality of care. And so we looked into the factors that make up high and very high risk diagnoses for the PIM3. So if you look at them, none of severe respiratory illness, so any stage of ARDS or HIV were included in the PIM3 model. In fact, the validation of the PIM3 stated that the addition of HIV added no discriminatory value. And we just like to raise the question that perhaps in a setting like South Africa, where it may be a very different socioeconomic setting to the validation centers where PIM3 came from, that the omission of HIV as a risk diagnosis may be a contributing factor to the kind of SMRs we're seeing. And then furthermore, respiratory illness, particularly ARDS, the omission thereof may also be resulting in falsely low predictions of mortality. So with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for that, and thanks to all the speakers for staying on time as well. We're pretty much slightly ahead of time, which is great. So I will start the questions and answers session. And could people mute their mics if they're not speaking, please? Makes it easier. I'll start the questions and answers session. I have a few questions coming in, but I might just start with both Mervyn and Jose. Certainly Mervyn first. Many of the sort of diagnostic criteria, and I appreciate everything we do in medicine has to be contextual, but many of the diagnostic criteria or markers that guide us or signpost us toward the diagnosis are all so nonspecific. And you even mentioned yourself that they can, you know, rise in infection, but also in other non-infectious conditions like the hemophagocytic syndrome. But one question that's coming in is, one, what would you recommend, therefore, in the immunocompromised patient as your empirical starting antimicrobial treatment? And then maybe Jose can pick it up from there and maybe give some insights. What are your empirical antifungal treatments for a similar population?
My simple answer would be it very much depends on the local ecology of the hospital or the area. Depends again very much on are they coming in fresh from the community or have they been in hospital for a while. So it's very much predicated on it's very much predicated on what type of infection is it likely to be resistant. So again, in our hospital we have a very large hemoncology population and they have an escalating type of antibiotic, so we don't automatically go for meropenem, for example, because in the UK generally we have a low level of multi-resistant organisms. I know, you know, Jose may want to comment in Spain, where I know they have a different situation, so they might be more aggressive. You know, I know in New York, for example, they often start with colistin, which is something we very rarely use. So I think it very much depends on your local resistance patterns and obviously what you think. If it is an infection, do you think it's bacterial, viral, fungal?
Okay.
Regarding the empirical use of antifungal, I think that it depends especially on the clinical level, situation of the patient. If the patient is really sick, if the patient has a respiratory failure of course, you have to initiate as soon as possible antifungal agents. And traditionally, we use liposomal amphotericin B because it covers aspergillus, it covers mucor, and this wide spectrum has made that amphotericin B, liposomal amphotericin B, has been traditionally, at least in my experience, the empirical antifungal. But nowadays we know that the use of voriconazole is associated with a lower mortality. And if you have a suspicion of an aspergillus, nowadays I use voriconazole empirically. You can use a combination with voriconazole plus liposomal amphotericin B. Perhaps if you have some doubts about the possibility of a mucor that has a very high mortality, and isavuconazole could be a very, very attractive option because, as I mentioned before, isavuconazole covers not only aspergillus, but also it covers other filamentous fungi, including mucor. Of course, the situation is completely different. If your suspicion is a pneumocystic gyrovasit, in that case you have to add cotrimoxazole to trimetoprim sulfamethoxazole because it is the natural choice for this infection. In this case, the pattern, the radiological pattern, is quite different from pneumocystis to other type of fungi, especially aspergillus or other filamentous fungi. So if you suspect the pneumocystis, you initiate cotrimoxazole.
Okay, thank you for that. We're all very obsessed now with the whole sepsis. There's lots of campaigns, certainly in the UK, of sepsis kills, the sepsis six. And I appreciate that much of that is aimed at the junior doctor at 2 a.m. who comes across a sick patient. You don't want them to delay what is essentially a time-critical illness. But I'm just wondering now, are we over-prescribing antibiotics? And secondly, should antifungals be part of the sepsis 6? It's going to get very expensive if they are.
Do you want my provocative views first?
Please.
I think, unfortunately, and there'll be quite a number of groups who are actually looking at the evidence very hard. And essentially, I know a few infectious disease groups have submitted papers that are under peer review, looking at not only sepsis, but trying to divide sepsis from septic shock, and then looking at things like pneumonia presenting to emergency departments, abdominal infections, urinary infections, etc. And the evidence base isn't strong. And certainly in the UK, and I know in the United States as well, there are actually ongoing discussions with government bodies to actually say we need to rebalance it. So I think the point Jose made earlier, if you have a very sick patient with septic shock, I think it's reasonable to be aggressive. I think many of the other cases, you do have time, you know, a number of hours. So I'm not saying unnecessary delay, but you've got a number of hours to get some tests done and try and work out, is this patient really infected? Is it a bacterial rather than a viral infection, for example? And so you've got a bit more time to actually be a bit more considered. You know, my analogy is somebody bleeding to death. You know, you're a trauma surgeon, Morgan. You know, if this patient's bleeding to death, you're not going to wait for a full cross match in that patient. Sure. Whereas if they're anemic but not compromised, you're not fussed about a delay in doing that full cross match. So I think I would argue a very similar situation applies.
Okay. Of course,
do you think that in the patients who are not immunocompromised, who develop sepsis at 2 o'clock in the morning, do you think that fungi are going to result in the demise of that patient in the next couple of hours, or you have enough time to do a little bit of work around and maybe start that antifungal at 8 a.m.?
Yes, that's a very good point, because I think that fungal infection usually doesn't present like a shock. So I think that you have to wait 2, 3, 4 hours. It's reasonable. And of course, you have to put the balance between how many times you have to to wait. You have to wait for 2 days, probably is too much. But a patient in septic shock, obviously, usually, is a bacterial infection. It's not a lung infection. This infection present more frequently like respiratory failure, especially in pneumocystis. And of course, the clinical presentation is not fulminant like a patient with a septic shock for a Staph aureus or for a pseudomonas that can be almost fulminant. So I think that we have to balance between the clinical situation, how much we have to wait. Probably several hours is reasonable, is logical. Otherwise, I have to say that nowadays the cost of antifungal is much lower than it was before. For example, voriconazole, the cost of voriconazole has decreased substantially. So I think that that's not a problem of cost nowadays, but it's more a reason for a logical approach to the patient.
If I can ask something provocative to all three of you, maybe Cuba at the start, because of the higher rates of HIV in sub-Saharan Africa. But are we going too far? I mean, you've got a young patient who has a serious, for example, in Jose's talk, a serious underlying hematological malignancy, put them in the intensive care unit in the first place, and now they have an invasive fungal condition. You know, how far do we push these patients? I'm not really talking about the money, I'm talking about the ethics of, but we know the mortality is going to be extremely high, and even if they don't die, or even if they get out of ICU, their morbidity is very high as well.
So I think that kind of scenario lends itself to the availability of resources in any given environment. So the answer that I give you coming from Soweto, Johannesburg, might be very different from Carlos or Mervyn. One of the things that, because our number of ICU beds relative to the demand is woefully inadequate, we look at a principle of probability of benefit. And it's not something that we have a magic formula for, but we try and work out that when we try and offer patients the highest level of care in our hospital, do we at least at the start have some idea of significant reversibility of the acute condition and some kind of idea of whether we'll be able to return that patient to a reasonable quality of life thereafter. If we don't get the sense of that, then unfortunately that's the kind of patient that becomes one of our poor candidates for ICU in our environment rather than in absolution.
I personally have never met a hematologist or oncologist who will say, stop treatment, give up.
I think that's the reason why we work in what has become called a closed ICU, because ultimately, with the competing interests of all the multiple subspecialties within a large hospital, it befalls upon the intensive care specialist to try and make those kind of judgment calls. When you and the referring team on the same page, that's the first prize, but it doesn't always happen.
Yeah, we've managed over the years to educate our hematologists and oncologists, and what we try and do early on is to have an honest, realistic discussion with obviously the patient if they're competent to do so, or their family, because I think a lot of the time there's perhaps an over-optimistic view of the treatment and the ease with which the complication can be managed. So over the years, we've been trying hard to re-educate the oncologists. And to be fair, I think they have taken that on board. And I think we're much better now than we were 10, 20 years ago at explaining benefits, risks, probability of survival, and quality of life afterwards. And obviously with cancer, you know, how long are they expected to live even if they get through their acute illness?
I fully agree with Mervyn, because I think that this patient should be discussed by the teams, by the oncology, hematology, by the ICU team, not at 2 a.m. or a Saturday night. They have to be discussed in weekdays, because these patients are deteriorating slowly, normally. And of course, the opinion of the oncologist or the hematologist is very, very important. And I think that the situation has changed the last year, because I think that, this is my experience and the majority of the Spanish hospital, there are regular meetings between ICU team and oncologists or hematologists, and they discuss patients, complicated patients. Of course, sometimes there are differences, sometimes we reach an agreement. And the ICU trial is also a term that has been included in your language, because the patient is admitted to the ICU for 2-3 days, not for a longer period of time if the patient is not doing well. And they admit that they assume that this could be a good approach. Let's admit the patient to the ICU. The patient, 2-3 days, the patient is not doing well. The organ failure is increasing, so it doesn't make sense to continue. Otherwise, if the patient is doing well, of course, everybody's happy, so we have done the best. So I think that the interaction between the teams is essential for improving the prognosis, or for doing the thing that they have to be done. The patient doesn't have any other alternative, we have to stop. And I think that the oncologist and the hematologist are learning to say stop.
Okay, yeah. Thank you. Yeah. I have one more question. This is for Professor Singer. It's how do you collaborate with startups to use and try and improve those devices? I assume this person is asking about the imaging device of the bacteria inside lungs.
Yeah.
And obviously it's very difficult to answer because it's still very experimental at a scientific level, never mind medical level. Any insights for that question?
Yeah, no, I think your point, Morgan's accurate in that there are obviously, there may be academic initiatives, there may also be industry initiatives, like actually earlier this morning, I'm working with a small British biotech company to see if we can do continuous antibiotic monitoring with microdialysis. And the idea is that you have some very clever engineers who aren't necessarily au fait with clinical aspects. So you work together as a team where the clinician informs the scientist and the scientist informs the clinician. Yes. And that way you work together to build up something that hopefully A is what we need from a clinical point of view, but obviously the engineering has to suit clinical needs. So if you have a very complicated device, it's never going to be used as a point of care device. And so you work together, and so you form relationships either with academic groups, bioengineers, physicists, chemists, whatever, or with startup companies, and then try and forge that collaboration together. And then again, when you're going for a grant application, again, it's much better to show you're a good team offering different perspectives.
Okay, thank you for that. There's no further questions have come in, so I'd like to thank again our three speakers,
Robert
Singer, Carlos, and also Ruben, for your time today and for very insightful talks on lung sepsis in the immunocompromised host.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.